Many of you may have seen a couple of weeks ago in Newsweek magazine, there was an op-ed that questioned whether or not Kamala Harris was eligible to be vice president based on the status of her parents when she was born in Oakland. It was an academic conversation that, of course, created a huge outcry. And we've got the author of that column today to create a huge outcry here. I'd like you to welcome to the stage for our next panel discussion, Liberty versus Security, the Constitution in Times of Crisis. Joining us first is Dr. John Eastman. He is chairman of the Federalist Society's Federalism and Separation of Powers Group. Those must be exciting luncheons to go to. He's also faculty of the Claremont Institute and Chapman University, and currently the visiting scholar for conservative thought at CU Boulder. Please welcome Dr. John Eastman to the stage. Joining him is Dr. Eastman, the female version. Dr. Elizabeth Eastman is a scholar as well, a senior scholar in residence at CU Boulder. She teaches political science, political philosophy, history, great books, philosophy in numerous colleges, and now she is working on a book in her home in Santa Fe, New Mexico. Dr. Elizabeth Eastman, welcome to the stage as well. I'd also like to welcome our moderator. You met her last night as she accepted her Blankley Fellowship from the Steamboat Institute. She's not wearing her Oxfords today, I want to point out. She's wearing fabulous shoes instead. Patrice Onwuka, welcome to the stage to moderate this.
Well, good morning, everyone. So our panelists are going to begin with a few prepared remarks of their own. I'll do some Q&A with them, and then we're going to open it up to your questions. As you know, there should be a QR code on your table. You can scan it, go to the website, and submit questions, and I'll be taking them a little bit later. Okay, Dr. Eastman.
All right. Thank you all very much for early morning. And I got to thank Jennifer, this marathon thing. I taught a class this week on Thucydides. And of course, Thucydides talks about the Peloponnesian War right after the Persian War, which ended when the Athenians beat the Persians at Marathon. And I would never do a marathon because the original guy ran that 26.2 miles and then promptly died. So man, kudos to her for being able to pull that off. Also, my wife, we both had our PhDs on the same day, but she got hers about 3 hours before I did, which she never forgets to remind me of. All right, so we're going to be looking at some of the legal authorities for what we've been dealing with over the last 6 months with COVID, and both federal and state authorities. Section 361 of the Public Health Service Act has long authorized the Department of Health and Human Services, or the CDC, to take measures to prevent the entry and spread of communicable diseases. They have that authority to do it from foreign countries under the International or the Foreign Commerce Clause in the Constitution. They have that authority to prevent the spread of diseases across states or between states from the Interstate Commerce Clause, and from a bad old New Deal era decision by the Supreme Court called Wickard versus Filburn. They even have the power to affect local decisions if in the aggregate the decisions locally have a substantial effect on interstate commerce. Now, I've been working a long time to try and overturn that old decision, but we're not there yet. President Obama's executive order back in 2014 that added SARS and other communicable respiratory diseases to the list of diseases that triggered these authorities, as it was in place long before COVID came along. Those kind of actions by the federal government and similar actions by the state governments were upheld by the Supreme Court more than a century ago in a case dealing with mandatory vaccines and smallpox up in Massachusetts called Jacobson versus Massachusetts. The states similarly have very broad police powers, they're called. The power to regulate the health and safety, welfare, and morals. We kind of overlooked that last word for more recently, but the morals of the people. And every state has, in advance of any potential emergency, authorized their governor, their executive, their unelected health officials to take actions to deal with an emergency. Colorado's no different. The Colorado Disaster Emergency Act allows for the governor to take certain emergency actions. But here's, it's important, emergency actions to provide for the prompt and efficient response to unforeseen emergencies. Emergency is even defined in the statute as unexpected events that places life or property in danger and requires an immediate response, things that are imminent. So at some point, you have to question when the emergency response all of a sudden becomes a complete obliteration of our notions of separation of powers. The authority to respond immediately is supposed to be there until the legislature can get back in session and deliberate about the proper policy judgments to respond to the emergency. That's not what's been happening. We have instead now government on autopilot by a governor and executive doing lawmaking, or worse, unelected officials in the health agencies doing lawmaking. I believe that as the time goes on now, these kind of challenges to the executive orders are going to be more salient, because we're now well past the initial onset of the emergency, the initial urgency of it, and we ought to be able to deliberate with our legislators, who after all reflect our will through the legislature in making policy judgments. The doctrine is called the non-delegation doctrine. It's an archaic doctrine in the U.S. Constitution. It's buried deep, deep inside the text, so I would excuse you all for missing it. It's Article 1, Section 1, Clause 1, right at the beginning of the thing. It says the legislative powers herein granted are vested in Congress, not in an unelected agency, not even in an executive. Congress is supposed to be the one making the hard calls on policy trade-offs once we get beyond the emergency necessity. Colorado's Constitution has even a more clear-cut non-delegation doctrine. It says in Article 3, the powers of the government of this state are divided into three distinct departments, the legislative, the executive, and the judicial. And in case anybody missed the fact that they're supposed to be distinct, it goes on and says, and no person or collection of persons charged with the exercise of powers properly belonging to one of these departments shall exercise any power properly belonging to either of the others, except as in this Constitution expressly directed or permitted. And I don't find anywhere in the Colorado Constitution the authority of the governor to make law, to execute the law, and then to judge the violations of the law. And yet the governor's most recent order here, July 16th, the mask order, he's written himself in criminal and civil penalties for violating his orders. So he's not only made the new mandate, but he's attached the penalty to it. He can revoke business licenses for any business that doesn't comply with his order. So he's judge, jury, lawmaker, executor, and judge, all in one at our nation's founding. When you combined all three branches of government, they had a word for that. It was tyranny. It was the same word that was used yesterday, right? And so these are the kind of things that are going on. What are some of the other constitutional challenges that might be brought? So far, most of them have fallen on deaf ears in the courts. But we see, for example, the First Amendment's freedom of speech and freedom of assembly are being trampled pretty routinely by some of these state executive orders. And they are increasingly content-based orders. So we'll allow Black Lives Matter protests in the streets without social distancing and without masks, but not anti-governor edict protests. That distinction on content base will allow the one content that we like and not the kind of content that we don't. It's blatantly unconstitutional. And when you have a content-based restriction on speech, like we've been seeing, it's subject to what we call strict scrutiny. The government can only succeed if there is a compelling governmental interest and the restriction is narrowly tailored to that interest. And that's almost impossible to meet on a content-based restriction. The Second Amendment. We had orders closing gun stores in several states around the country as non-essential businesses. In New York, in our home state of New Mexico now, in Los Angeles, the county sheriff did that just on his own, revoked his order when the NRA filed suit. And then the Federal Department of Homeland Security weighed in and described gun shops as essential infrastructure, which was, we were in California trying to sell our house at the time, And I was really nervous because we'd already moved our gun collection to New Mexico. And the one time I thought I might need it, I was... But the federal government has now defined gun shops as essential infrastructure, which means that under the Supremacy Clause of the Constitution, that requirement of the federal government or that description preempts any state law defining them as non-essential. So the gun shops should be good for now. We have another one. The Privileges and Immunities Clause of Article 4 says that citizens of each state shall be entitled to all the privileges and immunities of citizens in the several states. So when Rhode Island's governor issued an order preventing New Yorkers from entering the state, now there are a lot of states that would like to prevent New Yorkers from entering in their state, I know. But they're not allowed to treat different state citizens differently. Now, if they'd had an order that said anybody coming from New York, whether they're Rhode Islanders returning or New Yorkers coming in because of the hot spot in Manhattan, that probably would have been permissible. But just targeting people that had New York license plates on their cars, blatantly unconstitutional. We've got other things, and this we'll talk quickly about this. Fifth Amendment's Takings Clause. You know, you get some fires around here, as we do down in Santa Fe, as we did in California. Sometimes the fire departments will burn some houses in the path of the fire to create a fire break to save everybody else. That's providing a public good, and we owe a just compensation for that. Similar to shutting down some businesses to stop the spread of this disease as a fire break, I think there should be just compensation paid to those particular businesses shut down. Fifth Amendment and the 14th Amendment Due Process Clause. They can't deprive us of our liberty or our property arbitrarily. And I'll give one good example. I was teaching in our Claremont Institute Publius Fellows program. Rough duty, we were down at the Rancho Bernardo Golf Resort in San Diego back in June, and I had the morning off and I wanted to rent a set of golf clubs to go play around. And the governor's order had gotten very specific. They were not allowed to rent out golf clubs. Now, this was a fancy club, and most of the people come with their own clubs, so those clubs have been sitting in the back closet for months, I'm sure. But the COVID guy must have been hanging out on the shaft, unlike hanging out in the grocery carts that I had just come from, that 1,000 people had already touched that morning. I think that qualifies as arbitrary, and government's not supposed to be able to do that. A lot of the things that people are pushing back on of just the nonsensical stuff we're seeing. Let me then take the most significant threat, the Religious Liberty Clause of the First Amendment. Congress shall pass no law abridging the free exercise of religion. And that applies to the states via the 14th Amendment. But for about 30 years, since the Justice Scalia decision, Employment Division versus Smith, they have watered down the protections of the free exercise clause so much that there's not much constitutional right left to claim there. It was blatant in Nevada when the governor's order there shut down all the churches, or more precisely, limited them to 50 people, no matter how big the congregation space was, but allowed the casinos to open up at 50% capacity, no matter how large. So you've got 2,500 people in a casino jumping for joy when they hit the jackpot, spreading the COVID germ everywhere, but the church couldn't, have 50 people or more in it. That was a blatant violation of the free exercise clause, I think properly understood. But when it gets up to the Supreme Court, Chief Justice Roberts joins with the four liberals of the court and refuses to issue a stay of that order. These threats against religious liberty are now becoming targeted in order to shut down people of faith and using the COVID as an excuse. And I think it's high time we start fighting back against that. Let me close with this, a couple of hurdles that have arisen as we start pushing back on this. I had a group of San Diego businessmen contact me to try and figure out how to bring a lawsuit to protect their businesses. All of the lawsuits, because courts are highly deferential to claims in emergencies of executive officials, and there's this perverse incentive. If the rule that comes down is true draconian, if they were wrong about that, if they were overly aggressive, well, then there's no spread of the virus. They get to claim their draconian measures worked. But if they're too soft and there's something that goes wrong, then it's blood on their hands. And so the incentive is to just ratchet up the regulations to the highest point possible. The second thing, the businessmen, when I told them how hard it would be to win the lawsuit, they said, well, why don't we just engage in civil disobedience? Just get all of us together and stay open. And I said, that's a great idea, but here's the problem. Every one of your insurance policies probably has an illegal act exclusion. And until we can confront the illegality of the governor's orders, if something goes wrong, not just COVID-related, but anything goes wrong in your business while you're operating contrary to that governor's orders, your insurance policy is going to exercise that illegal act exclusion and say, we're not covering you. How many businesses feel like they could operate without any insurance at all, given the amount of liability that they might have? And they quickly had to fold up their tents and say, okay, we'll comply. These things, I think, have to be confronted if we're going to push back on this. Maybe an act of Congress, if we win in November a House of Representatives that's sensible again, might actually provide some immunities or limitation on those illegal act exclusions when what they're really challenging is an illegal act of the governor. Thanks so much.
So I'd like to thank the Steamboat Institute for the invitation to speak, and I just need to add one thing. I was 8 months pregnant when I got my dissertation. I defended at 9, he defended at 1. So they let me go first. They were just a little on edge, these three wonderful members of my committee. Okay, the title of the panel is Liberty versus Security, the Constitution in Times of Crisis. John's remarks focused on examples of constitutional violations that we're experiencing in our daily lives. My remarks focus on remedies. Another way to put it is, he's the passion, I'm the reason.
Oh, thanks.
This is our life. This is our dining table, let me tell you. I thought of a couple of working titles for my thoughts. First one, why liberal education matters and how it can serve as a remedy to our present conditions, or kindergartners on the front lines, the fight for education against indoctrination. Both titles sum up the contents of my remarks. On the one hand, liberal education is a direct counterpart to indoctrination. On the other hand, our children, from kindergartners to college graduates, have been on the front lines. They have been subjected to indoctrinations and deprived of an education that lays the foundation for being good citizens and taking on the duties and responsibilities in our democratic republic. Such an education also preserves our liberties and increases our opportunities to live a good life. Before I continue, I must acknowledge that there are exceptions found in good homeschooling efforts, some schools, programs, and colleges around the country that embrace the ideals of a liberal education, and of course, classroom teachers and professors who fight against the educational behemoth. We offer recognition, praise, and support, but we must turn our efforts to expanding these exceptions and reclaiming education. Recognize this for what it is. It is a war. We are fighting to preserve America, the institutions and principles that changed the course of our history centuries ago, and the future. The battle must be fought on many fronts, but my focus today is on liberal education. I have the great privilege of a one-year appointment at the University of Colorado Boulder as a senior scholar at the Benson Center for the Study of Western Civilization. I'm not speaking on behalf of the program, but I believe that my remarks are consistent with the goals and aspirations of the center. First, what is liberal education? In contrast to a manual education where one learns skills, a liberal education is intended to free the mind. Understood in the broadest meaning, it encompasses four things: education to be a human being, education to make the most of our human powers, education for our responsibilities as members of a democratic society, and education for freedom. The common element of these four points is that we are talking about individual human beings who can thrive in a liberal society in a democratic republic. This is in sharp contrast to a totalitarian regime in which the private and the individual is diminished or denied and uniformity prevails. Anastasia Lynn spoke to this yesterday afternoon. The mind is closed in such a regime rather than opened and enriched. The aims of a liberal education are achieved by reading and discussing great books that reach as far back as the classical Greeks, Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, and continue through the centuries to present day, Shakespeare, Montesquieu, Jane Austen, Tocqueville, and others. These works and others free the mind. We hold opinions, but how do we test those opinions and transition from opinion to knowledge to truth? Oftentimes, a liberal education takes place at a seminar table where students and teachers discuss readings, question, challenge, and engage the author, as well as those participating in the discussion. This image brings me to my second point. What is the value of a liberal education? It is twofold. First, the content of the readings expands our experiences through thought. One of my teachers spoke of the three R's which a liberal education ought to achieve: respect, rationality, and reverence. We have the freedom to express our opinions in a republic, and oftentimes we tolerate those with whom we disagree, though we are currently experiencing the very disturbing phenomenon of a cancel culture when one does not fall in line with the prevailing pronouncement of the day. That's a topic for another time. Being respectful of the opinions of others, quote, begins with an attentive look at opinions and an attempt to see where they come from and why they are as they are, close quote. I'm quoting my teacher. Always quote. One moves from discussion of books and ideas at the seminar table or classroom to our daily lives, where we try to understand people's opinions and their prejudices. By taking those with whom we disagree seriously, they more readily engage and may well re-examine the positions they hold. Rationality, the second R, is drawing on our ability to solve problems, to be objective, to compromise, and to form principles. Students who have read great books, such as Thucydides' Peloponnesian War, and others have engaged in these exercises and can apply them to their lives after graduation. Also, we have the blessing of living in a society where there's a free exchange of ideas, though we are currently in a battle to preserve it, but we must discern and defend principles that are worthy of our freedom. Finally, the third R is reverence. We must revere the founding documents of this nation, beginning with the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. Young and old must know the rights and principles that were articulated at the founding of this nation and the government designed to secure them. The stance of reverence is the firm foundation upon which we can stand to defend them. Liberal education, both the content and the habits, begins in the private sphere of the student and is carried into the public sphere of the citizen as one reaches adulthood. Such an education not only enriches our lives, but it contributes to the means to perpetuate our free society where such studies are allowed. No such thing exists in a totalitarian regime. And sadly, in many institutions of so-called higher learning, because free minds are a threat to the uniformity and indoctrination that must exist for it to maintain its power over the people or its student body. My third and last point on liberal education is that it exposes a totalitarian posture for what it is. It is an assault on the individual, on our communities, on our government, and our country. Some of you may watch the program Life, Liberty, and Levin. A recent episode featured Attorney General William Barr. His remarks echo what I'm sharing with you today. Barr began with the observation that things have fundamentally changed since he was Attorney General 30 years ago, that politics has become all-consuming. The left wing has really withdrawn and pulled away from the umbrella of classical liberal values that have undergirded our society since our founding. Within the family, we have had two ways of resolving disputes. One is the discussion, the dialectic, the marketplace of ideas, trying to arrive at the truth. We had an idea that there was some truth to arrive at. Barr continued, and then, if we couldn't reach agreement, we vote. Nowadays, the left has essentially withdrawn from this model and really represents a Rousseauan revolutionary party that believes in tearing down the system. Jean-Jacques Rousseau is a 17th century philosopher whose ideas influenced Marx. You can trace out that thread of thought. Barr added, that's what's wrong about America today. All has to do with the institutions we have, and we have to tear them down, and they're interested in a complete and political victory. The left is not interested in compromise. The left is not interested in a dialectical exchange of views. It's a secular religion. They view their political opponents as evil because we stand in the way of their progressive utopia that they are trying to reach. That's what gives the intensity to the partisan feelings that people feel today. Because for them, this pilgrimage, we're all in a political pilgrimage, everything is reduced to politics. For people who don't have that perspective, politics is important, but it's not the whole purpose of life. Barr's description is that of a world where liberal education has been diminished or rejected. recognition of the value of a liberal arts education and its ability to expose illiberal practices and preserving it is only the beginning. We must adopt the posture of fighting for what we believe. I propose the following. One, would I like to remake higher education so that a liberal education is embraced by many and indoctrination is stopped in its tracks? Yes. Can I? No. Taking on tenured faculties, many of whom are actively involved in radical progressive agendas in universities, is almost impossible. More often than not, the administration is sympathetic to them or feckless in their posture. An effective way to circumvent this is to establish fund programs or centers at universities that teach much of what I am proposing. Not every college or university is going to be open to hosting such programs, but oftentimes the prospect of funding gets the attention of administrators. It's a foot in the door, and that's precisely why my husband and I are privileged to spend the year at the Benson Center. Take that word seriously. Two, pay attention to local elections, in particular school board elections. Kimberly Strassel mentioned this yesterday. Some are as small as five elected members who wield tremendous amounts of power in deciding K-12 policies. Run for the school board, or find and back candidates who are willing to advance sound educational programs. The same holds for state legislatures who draft content standards and curricula for public schools. Third, my last recommendation is to read and to volunteer in classrooms. I read every book that was assigned to my children throughout their K-12 experience and most of the books that they read in college. I love to read, but there was another reason. My two children were in public schools for K-12. It was a conscious decision that my husband and I made. I didn't like everything that I read, but I could engage my children and gently steer the conversation when I was concerned. Even if you don't read all the books, ask questions, look at the course curriculum or syllabus, and inform yourself. By volunteering in classrooms, you have a firsthand view to what is happening, and it's another means to engage them. And let me tell you, teachers are very aware when there's a parent in the classroom. It's another check. These are only three suggestions, but what they have in common is that everyone here participates in the solution. Our children are on the front lines. Don't let them battle by themselves. Stand with them, support them, and ready them for the fight that they will wage for the rest of their lives. I am not ready to give up on K-12 or colleges and universities. Just like if I were a general, I wouldn't walk away just because an enemy had a stronghold. Invest wisely and thoughtfully, become politically involved, and know how to answer the questions about whether your children and grandchildren are being educated or indoctrinated. The future of our country depends upon it, as does the future of their lives and ours. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Eastman. We're going to just take a moment for the podium to be removed, and then we will continue our discussion with them. Okay, perfect. Well, thank you for inviting us into your dining room. I believe you said it's passion and reason. So this is going to be fun. I'm taking away that we have long-term and short-term plays. Short-term being around the politics and maybe the judicial route. Long-term being around cultural change and educational changes. So I'm going to throw some questions at both of you because I think it's important for us to take apart a little bit more what you talked about. So Elizabeth, I'm going to start with you. You talk about education, and how many people are familiar with the 1619 Project, sponsored by the New York Times? Yes, unfortunately, it's a sinister project to suggest that every single institution in our country is racist because of slavery, and the founding of our nation was, in fact, when the first slaves were brought to this country. Insane, I know, but it is unfortunately seeped into academia and into now our K-12 system. Can you talk about
what that has meant and how that has changed, you know, the way students are learning about our history and the appreciation for our founding principles.
Well, I'll simply say briefly, this isn't the first assault. This is the latest assault on history, on standards, on content. This is nothing new. You know, as a political scientist, I'm very much interested in political sociology, and I watch the candidates on the left, and they are relentless. They will never give up. And so, take them for what they are. It's almost like they will constantly be marching in lockstep, and they will take every opportunity they have. We just have to be a little bit smarter and a little bit quicker and just really, really ready to take them at the word that they advance, which is rarely the truth. It's a narrative. So let me just take an aside for a minute and give a plug to the Benson Center. One of the things that my husband and I are responsible for is putting together a lecture series. Go on the website. Shortly you'll be seeing the listing of lectures this fall, and one of them is by a very fine scholar by the name of Lucas Morrell, whose lecture title is called 1619 Project, A Missed Opportunity. And he's written some great stuff. And quite honestly, I'm going to have my students that day of class read excerpts from the 1619 Project, and I'm going to make sure they understand what's at stake. With respect to education in general, the left is always trying to sway the debate, and it's dangerous, it's corrosive, and ultimately they are going in a very direct direction. They don't hide. That's the thing that's extraordinary. It's the enemy that's absolutely front and center. Hey, it's all right there. You can Google it and you can read it in the next 10 minutes. Absolutely. And so see it for what it is. And at the same time, you can list all of the scholars who have come out against it, learn their arguments, and become conversant with it, with them.
Somebody yesterday talked about Martin Luther King Jr.'s letter from Birmingham jail. He didn't criticize the American founding as being racist. He criticized it for not living up to the ideals that it set for itself. That meant it was a noble founding, and that he wanted us to aspire to live up to the goals that we set out for ourselves. The Declaration of Independence is the greatest advance in human history on this question. Our Constitution, which had to compromise with slavery, but studiously avoided even the word slavery so as not to taint it and to allow for it to be eliminated as soon as was humanly possible. These are things to celebrate that we accomplished as much as we did, and yet they want to tear it all down.
Very good. And I forgot to mention, if you have questions, I see them populating here, but please scan the QR code, submit your question, and I'll get them, and we'll get to them in a couple minutes. So let's talk about the constitutional issues that you've raised, but largely let's talk about government expanding during times of crisis. Talk about a couple of different historical situations where we've seen government expand, and did it ever retract? Yeah. And do we expect a retraction of government power now?
So some of the worst expansions, unconstitutional expansions, occurred in the New Deal era in response to the Great Depression. One of the significant Supreme Court cases of that era said that, well, we can ignore the obligations of contracts. This was about foreclosures and whatever, because of the emergency. Now, the Contracts Clause in the Constitution was put in place because of a depression that was going on in the 1780s and was leading to, you know, riots and what have you, and they put this protection of contracts in there in the middle of a crisis, in an emergency, and yet, you know, 150 years later, they say, well, because of the emergency, we can pretend that constitutional obligation no longer follows. And it's been off to the races ever since on ignoring the limits on the Constitution. This is why education is so important. If our fellow citizens don't understand what our own Constitution means, how can they possibly insist that the government stay in compliance with it? It's absolutely essential that we teach something. Even the non-delegation doctrine that I talked about, it's a little archaic, but where's it come from? It comes from the notion in the Declaration of Independence that we have inalienable rights from God, not gifts from government, and that the sole legitimate purpose of government is to protect those rights, and that the government, to be legitimate, has to be based on the consent of the governed. When I let an unelected health official like Dr. Fauci decide policy judgments for 330 million people, we're no longer ruling ourselves by our consent. It goes right to the core of those founding principles. And yet, our young people hardly have been exposed to those founding principles at all. Or if they are, it's, you know, those old racist white guys from Europe. I mean, they have no conception of the significant advance in human history that Declaration of Independence was.
Would you like to pick up where he left off and talk about education, not just American history, but also world history? Have we seen a dearth of teaching at the K-12 level in particular, putting in context the amazing founding that we have within the larger history?
Yeah, one of my favorite slides that I share with my students when I assign them reading the Declaration and the Constitution. You've got to be able to read the text and be able to discuss them. That's the first step. But one of the slides that I share with them is, I say, look at all of the other world governments in 1776. There is nothing that even holds a candle to what was happening in the United States. And it's a basis of comparison. When they start seeing, you know, this list that I can tick off of all of these monarchies, they say, wait a minute, what? And then, you know, give the contrasting example of classical Greece that introduced a true democracy, but again, it was fundamentally different. What is a representative republic? All of the information is there. It's just so easy to bring in, and then they can decide for themselves. Well, you know, what does it mean to be created equal? Well, you know, and that it initiates the discussion. One of the things that saddens me a little bit is when we simply are dismissive of an entire generation. We can't. There are many students who are engaged, who want to learn, and if we can find ways to put this back into colleges and universities, like the plug I made for finding ways to implement programs or centers, the students are there. You'll always, you know, what you see on the news are the rabble-rousers, but believe you me, there's a very large percentage of students who want the knowledge. They're curious. Go ahead.
Abraham Lincoln gave a speech in 1858 in Chicago, a few days after the 4th of July. Missed the 4th of July itself, but he was celebrating the 4th of July, and he challenged, it was an audience of largely immigrants who had come into the country in the 1840s and 1850s. And he said, none of you have, by blood, any connection with the people that did our Declaration of Independence or drafted this Constitution. And yet, because of the universal principles espoused there, you are blood of the blood and flesh of the people that wrote those great documents. What made America exceptional is we created a government for the first time in human history based on universal principles, on self-evident truths. The reason people the world over try and come here rather than having to be, you know, walled off to stay into their country is because of those universal truths. We are exceptional because of that. Not the way Barack Obama went around, but America says they're exceptional, but so do the British and so do the French and so do the Nigerians and so do everybody else. Completely missed the point of what made us different in human history. That's something that I think we have to reinstill in our children and grandchildren if we're going to save this country. It's critically important.
Very good. Speaking as an immigrant, I hearken your comments. So I'm going to turn to your questions from the audience. We have a couple related to the Colorado governor's executive mask order and whether it's constitutional. Can he do this? What's going to happen to it?
Yeah, so look, my view is in the immediate aftermath of the COVID crisis last March, when nobody knew what was going on, nobody knew how to stop it, you had to have emergency response to the best based on the best information we had. That's why those statutory authorities delegate emergency imminent response to the governor or to the public health officials. But that was 5-6 months ago. Are you telling me that our legislature hasn't had time to kind of make the policy judgments? Our legislature, the people that directly implement the policy that we choose them to implement, the thing that makes it possible for us to govern ourselves. So my view is the 6 months has been more than enough time to deal with the imminent threat and more than enough time for our legislative representatives to weigh in with the policy judgments. That's not been happening. And so I think we've crossed a very important separation of powers line sometime in that 6 months. I would put it more like maybe the end of March, not the end of August, before that line was crossed. But I think there should be some pushback on that.
We have another question about the presidential executive order. So we heard quite a lot, particularly on CNN and a lot of the left-leaning news outlets. Maybe that's, I think I'm, you know, repeating myself, but about whether the president should use a certain wartimes act, the production act, the Defense Production Act, to compel private businesses to produce certain types of needed, needed things, PPE, masks, hand sanitizer, et cetera. How should we be thinking about the president's use of executive orders? And you know, do we think it's out of hand? Do we think it was right at the time? And looking forward, if perhaps we have another surge of coronavirus cases, you know, this comes back around, or some other pandemic in the future, what should we be thinking about when we elect conservative leaders and holding them accountable to their actions in office?
So a couple things going on there, and I've ever since President Trump was inaugurated, I've been watching carefully to decide whether he would stay within the lanes of constitutional authority given to him in his office, or whether he would take advantage of some of the unconstitutional precedents his predecessor made. And I've been most impressed that almost in every instance he's stayed within the lanes. This latest round of executive orders, I think he's pushing the limit on there. But you can see what's going on. Pelosi and the crowd had developed this notion that they would, you know, I mean, everybody agrees we ought to have another round of PPE and whatever, just a little bit. But she doesn't want to just have some agreement. She wants to use it to get a wish list of things she knows she could never get otherwise. Yeah. And basically extort the other side to go on with that wish list, or say, we're not going to give it to anybody, and with our control of the media, you'll be blamed for it. What Trump did with the latest executive order is basically call her bluff on that. And so maybe it's equalizing the power struggle in D.C. a little bit. I do think it's extremely important, though, to get back towards staying within those constitutional lines very quickly. Because if we don't, can you imagine, it's not going to be a President Biden, but a President Kamala Harris in 2025 or something saying, well, we've got an emergency of global warming, and that means I'm going to shut down all industry, I'm going to shut down your cars, I'm not going to let you eat meat because cow farts up in Montana, whatever the thing was. It can be very dangerous, and it removes our ability as a people to govern ourselves through our elected representatives. And I think it's critically important we keep that in mind.
A couple of questions that are very similar around how the government should fairly compensate homeowners or business owners if they need to take their property for as you mentioned, a just good cause. The question is, where does the money come from and who would decide the amount? And also, is there some sort of due process included in that mm-hmm. kind of confiscation of property?
Yeah, that's a good, so the analogy I gave was to taking somebody's house to create a fire break to protect the rest of the town. And by rights, that taking of that private property for the public good ought to be compensated. Otherwise, the whole benefit to the public good is being borne on the shoulders of the single property owner. And I think something very similar ought to play out here. It was on such a massive scale, it's hard to imagine. And when we're $25 trillion in debt, it's not the current public good that's picking up the tab, it's our great-great-grandkids that are going to be picking up the tab. And there's something deeply unsatisfying about that. But I do think we for those people that were forced to shut down to help stop the spread of this thing, we ought to try and at least provide some safety net, as we have done. And that seems perfectly compatible with our sense of justice, and that they are contributing to the public good. We ought not to make them bear that burden by themselves. But when this thing is over, we ought to treat the debt that has been created like we treated the national debt that existed after World War II, and make it our top priority to retire that debt within a decade or two, so that we're not handing an enslaved society to our grandchildren that kind of debt would impose on them.
Last question I give to you, Elizabeth. I love it. We hear you over there. You mentioned Attorney General Barr's comments, and he talked about secular religion and how a lot of the people we see who are so animated on the streets and taking, you know, want to tear everything down and destroy everything. It seems like destruction is their worship service, I guess, and because they lack some sort of religion. please explain to us the role of religion, how it has shaped individuals, and when there's a lack of some sort of moral compass, why people turn to destructive paths or everything else they turn to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the moral foundation of a nation is critical, especially if we're going to preserve our liberties. Now, is that a moral foundation based on Judeo-Christian values? Is it a moral foundation based on reason? Hey, we can read Socrates and Aristotle, and I can give you a pretty darn good argument for a system of ethics based on reason. Or is it better to have a combination of the two? You know, all of you are individuals. It's not for a government to mandate what you believe. It's for you, through your reason, through your practice, through your, you know, the raising of your families, you decide, and you come to a, you know, an understanding of a moral foundation that's going to be consistent with principles that allow us to, you know, live good lives. Now, Bill Barr, he is a smart cookie. Can you imagine, I'm sitting there watching the television and somebody's invoking Rousseau? He's like, that's what I teach, this is wonderful. But no, he really gets it, and he was able to speak to these problems on a variety of different levels. But what the left has done, and I know we're at the end of our time, what the left has done is there's a certain fervor and a passion in our religious beliefs, but it's tempered because we're learning how to live our lives within a set of guidelines. But one of the problems with the left is they've completely shed any concept of a moderation, the moderating tendencies of a religious foundation, and they've simply let the fervor run wild. And that's very dangerous. That's what we're living through.
Elizabeth mentioned Montesquieu in her talk, and Montesquieu's famous for separation of powers that our founders get, but he also said something else very important. Every regime has to have an education suited to its people and its governing structures. In Republican form of government, more than any other, virtue is in the citizenry is essential. Because if you're not virtuous, capable of governing yourself, you can't possibly collectively govern yourselves. And our recovery of notion of civic virtue is absolutely critical.
Terrific. Thank you so much. Let's join me in thanking Dr. Eastman.
Thank you.
Thank you.